Good morning all and welcome to the first call. We're not far away from the first Group 1 of the new racing season. Emily, spring is nearly here. What an exciting time.
It sure is. We have been counting down the minutes till we get those winter months out of the way. And it's been a really significant race over the years. We've seen a number of champions progress on from here. Ocean Park, Tavistock, and in recent years, Carwee will be leading the field out on Saturday.
There's a couple of handy mares that have won the race too. Sea Change, and how can we forget the feats of the mare of the world, Sunlight? Who will Tony Lee call home in this year's edition of the Tazzy? No easy love could ever make me feel the same. Make me feel the same. Make me feel the same, same, same. Good morning all and welcome to the first call. Lovely to have you with us. The first day of spring, yes, we can feel it in the air as well with Group 1 racing coming to us from Hastings on Saturday. Good morning to you, Jason Tarn and Michael Guerin with us today. Aidan Rodley's on holiday. Great to have you as a part of the show with some pretty big news in the last 24 hours.
Look, it has been. First of all, about the racing, though, it's great to be here. I mean, you know, Group 1, it's a nice day to join the team, so I'm glad that Aidan's away. fantastic field. It's fallen away a little bit with a couple of horses missing, but the scratching of New York New York Minute this morning brings Frank Letter into play, which I think is better from a market perspective. Jason Tarn last night was a very interesting night for the industry in Hamilton. I think some surprises, some not. This isn't probably the show to talk about those so much, but there will be some around the country stunned by the sheer number of proposed track closures.
Yes, yeah, so significant track closures. Last night, Winston Peters gave a release of the Massara report that was commissioned just over 3 months ago. You could watch it live in person at Caldon's or online. I chose to do my foreman and watch it online. But the number of track closures, obviously a big discussion point. Another big discussion point is the dismantling, I suppose, or the proposed dismantling of the New Zealand Racing Board and its TAB broadcasting functions, and whether that gets contracted out or sold to Australia, what shape that will take and what the industry kickback will be in terms of dollars and duration that that contract will last.
Yeah, that conversation will be had a lot more in depth, gentlemen, on Weigh-In, which comes back to your screens at 10 o'clock on Sunday morning with input from not only the Minister and a very extensive, exclusive interview with Winston Peters, also Bernard Saundry, the boss of New Zealand Thoroughbred Racing, and John Allen for his reaction after hearing that maybe that board is going to be totally dismantled. Maybe not even maybe. It looks a fait accompli. So that's not what this show is about. We're to talk about the Tarzino and a whole bunch of great races around it, Matt.
Yeah, 10 o'clock on Sunday with three brand new panellists. You can jump on the track sign on Sunday morning and find out who they are. Let's have a look at our bank totals from last week and see how everyone got on with 3,132. I know the return's 357, but I actually lost last week.
Still well, still well clear.
$25
down. So there's a bit of work to be done, and we'll be doing that work this week.
Still lost, though.
So are you, like, is winter your go? Are you like a winter jumps man?
Yeah, big jumps man.
the Riccarton Carnival was just an absolute fill-up for
you. It was a fill-up, yeah.
Mm. Hometown fill-up.
And I tell you, there was a horse yesterday at Ashburton that won as well called Whiskey in the Jar. Aidan's tipped it out as this $2 each way bet at 50s or something, and it's come out yesterday and paid 50s and just went straight.
Do you know it's the most famous of all Irish folk songs?
Is it?
Whiskey in the Jar, covered by Metallica.
Okay. Maybe they might
do
talk about...
Do you want me to sing you some?
No, probably not.
No, good. I was hoping you would say no.
We don't have a music segment here on the first call, but one thing we do have, though, is Bevan Sweeney, who's standing by at Hastings to give us the latest on track conditions there. Morning, Sweens. How are things there in Hawke's Bay?
Yeah, morning, Lee. So, welcome into the Bay. I can tell you now, at the present moment, the sun is beating down. It would have to be, I don't know, 16, 17 degrees. They have had 6 mils of rain. Speaking to Andrew about 10 minutes ago, look, it can only improve with that forecast tomorrow. I think there's a high of 18 forecast for tomorrow with fine weather. If Danny just pans down to the track, this is the sort of ground where they've been out racing over the last month and a half or so. So that's clearly a little bit more cut up as we move over to the new ground, which traditionally on the first day of the Hawke's Bay is the place to be. And I think even though A lot of riders came off the inside on the first day last season. It was still very good down in this part of the track. So if Dan has a look at this, it's in perfect condition down here in the inside 3 or 4 metres, and it does walk a fraction better. Now, I am going to catch up with Richard Fenwick and try and drill a little bit further down into the pentrometer and ask about sites that they take the pentrometer down the straight, whether it's 5 and 10 and further out at different spots, and whether there was just a slight variation in that pentrometer to sort of say that it was going to be better to the inside. But look, the weather's perfect at this stage of the day. The forecast is outstanding. There's no real wobbles in that forecast that have been there across the last couple of years where we've had rain forecasts, so it should be on the improving mark through until tomorrow, maybe even racing close to that dead sort of rating with the weather that's about at the present moment. So look, it looks in wonderful condition. This ground towards the inside clearly just set a little bit better with a lack of racing over the last couple of months.
Bevan High Flyer is obviously a horse that everyone's got at least a bit of an interest in, the big one on Saturday. What about patterns for that horse? What would you like to see in the early part of the day to give us confidence to back a horse like High Flyer?
Well, I think if the inside's playing strongly, then he's got the absolute perfect draw for a horse who will posse up somewhere in the front end of the field. The one worry about High Flyer for me is he's not very big and he may be forced back towards the inside. So I think a key for Jonathan is to stay one off the inside. He's going to get cover, and I think he is a very good fresh horse. A couple of his best performances have been with cover till late in the race, and he shows a very explosive turn of foot. If the inside's on tomorrow, and you'd have to suggest that is going to be the pattern with the way the track looks at the present moment, it's got to be a massive chance in the race. There's going to be a lot of speed. Look, I think the horse that's trained to the minute for today, and others probably aren't there, is Sensible Princess. Her draw probably precludes her from being in the fight, because if they try and go forward, they will post her. But you're right, High Flyer, his form in Australia actually franks up very, very well. They were 2 very good runs. He's proven himself here in NZ, so he's a deserved second favourite in the market behind Melody Bell.
There's Bevan Sweeney with the latest on track conditions there at Hastings. He'll be part of the trackside coverage on Saturday, Channel 62. What did you take out of that, Jason, in terms of what Bevan had to say about track conditions?
Pretty much in line with what we traditionally see on a good, dead sort of track at Hastings. I know it's slow right now, but you're looking at on the better side of slow or the worst side of dead for tomorrow. That is, the inside is superior. The inside 3 to 4 is superior than wider. And in the last year's running of the race, look, first and second came from trail and 3 the inside, and there were a clump of horses that still stayed the inside even though it was rain affected and were in the finish. It was hard to make ground wide.
And that tends to be the case for all major carnivals in this country. The first day, Ellerslie in particular, plays to the inside and then they rough it up, and then as the carnival gets...
In Melbourne as well, like Flemington, the Derby day is a dead set rails day.
I think it's a day where the first couple of races, and particularly the first race, isn't a race I want to be heavily involved in. But I think a lot of people are going to watch it, gentlemen, and they're going to say inside or outside's on or off, because it's going to affect the way you gamble so much. If there is rain overnight, and if it becomes deeper down on the inside or they start to cut it up, then swoopers come into play and the Tarzino changes. If the Tarzino, being the obvious major race, is a race where we expect leaders to get away, all of a sudden, much like we saw at Tarapa, those who aren't in the first 5 have an enormous quest on 2 things. First of all, to overcome track bias, and secondly, to overcome group 1 horses in front of them. So early in the day, that's all I'm going to be thinking about, is how it's going to play for later on.
I suppose we're at a little bit of a disadvantage having to put some bets forward now, but we'll do
it. Well, it's interesting you say that. In race number 1, I've got my best bet of the day. I completely agree with what you're saying about it on form. I've got one in the first that,
well,
I think's a
very good. The thing about the first race is, you know, the inside's going to play for the first race because then no horses have been over it. Mm. As you know, it's races 4, 5, and 6. Once hundreds and hundreds of sets of hooves have been over it, that things start to change a bit.
Let's take a look at the market for the Tarzino, the first Group 1 of the season on the first day of spring. $6 High Flyer and $2.30. Hasn't raced for some time. Is that some concern? Could be said for Jon Snow as well. $7.50. Scott Base at the same price has trialled well. And we go down to the remainder of the field. Ocean Emperor there, $10, drops out of the Cranji Mile at his last start. And we'll go to the 3-year-old of the year from last season, Savvy Cove, who joins Melody Bell and Frankaletta, who's now in off the ballot at $8.50. And if we turn back 12 months ago, off the ballot, could be a good way to go with Frankaletta.
When I saw the race at Tarapa, and I know Julius is not here out of that race, and you have to respect Melody Bell, when I saw the race at Tarapa, my first thought was the winner of the Tarzino Trophy wasn't there. I think a lot of horses will come out of that race with a headache and they won't be feeling as good about life. And I think there's some horses who have been overseas and missed what was a really wet winter in this part of the world. Ocean Emperor, High Flyer, they've had sun on their back. I think they're coming back as fresh horses. One has trialled exceptionally well. I've got a funny feeling. And as I said, I'm not disrespecting Melody Bell or Frank Aletta, who's now on the field, that the winner wouldn't have raced at Tarapa 2 weeks ago.
How this race shapes is interesting, and I know Bevan sort of spoke of Jonathan Parks and High Flyer and not wanting to get to the rail. This is what I've formulated now. I think Frank Aletta, they'll aim to ride it positively. I'm not quite sure how hard Jonathan Parks will ride High Flyer from the gates. In Sydney, when he rode him there, he really wanted to keep him up to the mark. I'm not sure that he finishes it off quite as well if he's bustled early. That said, you don't want to end up in the mid part of the race or mid part of the field during the running when I anticipate there'll be a slackening of the pace. Jon Snow, you'd think, would push forward like he did in the Memsey last year from that draw. Ocean Emperor, Start Wondering, Sensible Princess. I'm not quite sure where they'll position, but I'm sure they'll be in the first six. I think for Sensible Princess, they'll look at the draw, they would have gotten over their initial feelings of probably being gutted. But they want to win this race, so I think they'll want to be positive on her.
You don't think Ocean Emperor, the way he's trialling, and as I said, having that sun on his back in Singapore over the winter where other horses have missed out on, you don't think they'll push the button and try and jump straight onto the markers?
Yes, I think, but, you know, Frank Aletta, I'm sure they'll want to do the same. She's that sort of horse, and I don't think Jon Snow's going to get there until maybe 200 or 300 metres sort of into that leading van, but I'm sure they'll want to just continue to roll forward with him. He's definitely a speed influence.
There looks to be a nice steady tempo, but there's not a tear-away 122 type leader in the race, Matt, so it's going to be incredibly hard for those horses back in the field to come swooping down the outside. When you are talking about five or six Group 1 winners, and frankly it is not that yet, but horses who are close to that form, racing on the speed on a good inside, it's a race where if you are considering backing a horse back in the field, and I think everybody who saw the Taupo trials last week liked what they saw about Sensible Princess, but I just can't back any horse from that draw all day, no matter how good it is, because she's going to need to potentially run past five or six Group 1 horses after covering more ground than them.
The Foxbridge is the first. We're taking a look at Melody Bell, successful in this for Shafiq Roussoff and Jamie Richards. Plenty to highlight out of this race. Authentic Paddy was good under the moonlight, hit the line well. Frank and Letta, there she is on speed. And you see Julius and Melody Bell start to hit the line strong. New York Mid at the inside is not there. Start Wondering's also in this race. Jason, what did you take out of this race as a positive moving forward? Is there one horse that caught your eye on this that you thought you want to back in the Tarzino?
Well, the winner, it's all about the winner to me. Obviously, Under the Moonlight was very good in her own right. Authentic Paddy's done that the previous two Foxbridge plates, done what he's done, run very well around the placings, fourth, fifth, and then he's gone into the Tarzino and has finished sort of fifth and just behind. Last year he had a pretty tough run and finished back. So I'm wary about, say, a horse like Authentic Paddy catching your eye and wanting to go on him. It's all about Melody Bell there. By all accounts, she's improved out of that, which is a big plus. She's the one horse that you definitely want to be taking out of it. I wouldn't underestimate Under the Moonlight, but she's going to find herself in a really tough position in the map. If for whatever reason there is no relenting in the speed, and I still think that there will be a mid-race slackening, then it will be a bit tricky for her. Like, she's run fourth last year, you know, an unlucky sort of fourth in many respects, even though she caused a lot of the carnage. But I don't want to be underestimating her. But you can't be, you know, you say that about five or six. You've still got to make a call on
one.
Well,
on that race, Melody Bell's clear top pick out of that bunch, out of the horses who went through Tarapa, and then just as clearly second for me is Frank Aletta. She's a big, round type of a horse, and she went into that race without the trial. She had missed the trial the week before at Teteka with them being cancelled or Taupo. One of them was cancelled, Teteka it was. She was very good there, and she'll probably get across them even easier here if, in fact, you're right and she's going to lead. So I think the two mares come out of the race better, but we're still maybe, you know, trying to not pay enough respect to Ocean Emperor's a very good horse. Scott Bass is a very good horse. Where he posies up is potentially the question. And High Flyer has that winter form at a higher level than many of these. And Jon Snow ran sixth in the Memsey, fresh up last year. Now, if any other horse who was in the Menzies was in this race, you'd be like, wow, it's got to be the one to beat. Here he is at the trials. Now, Gift of Power is in front, and she's a very different type of horse, a speedster. We'll see her earlier in the day. She gets away. He was very good here, just kept on closing, kept on closing, kept on closing. To me, he looks a fit horse. The week before at Teteco, he was also very good at the trials.
Sensible Princess running third there. I don't really think there's too much between them trial-wise. The draws will make it interesting where they settle and the types of runs that they get. But yeah, he's, what, three lengths or so behind Vega Magic last year in the Memsie. He was a length and a half from Blackheart Bart, Toss and Start, and was that. So, you know, that's obviously, it is a very good form reference.
He's going to need to be good to win it because he's probably going to need to roll across to outside the lead. I don't think he's a change-up storm down the outside.
There are a few horses in there with genuine turns of foot, like High Fly. Yep. I think Sensible Princess, when she won at Pukekohe, showed that she's got a real sprint and the ground will suit her perfectly. And you've got Scott Bass. Well, you know, he ran sectionally faster than Melody Bell on Karaka Million Night, winning over the mile. And, you know,
what did you make of his trial here? Here he is outside the leader. I thought the leader was exceptional here, and I think he could win the race, Ocean Emperor. What did you make of Scott Bass? Was that enough to suggest to you he could run past the horse in front tomorrow?
It did, and the reason I say that is because, you know, the trial pressure in the first half of this was very tepid, and whilst you might want to have seen him instantaneously pick up and get a bit closer to Ocean Emperor, I don't want to be placing too much stock on a no-pressure trial like that. I respect very much how well to the eye Ocean Emperor looks. I think they both need to find a level, and maybe Scott Bass has to find a fraction more than what Ocean Emperor is showing. But maybe he is going to be that much more forward in terms of condition than others, Ocean Emperor, tactically he should get.
Is his three-year-old form, you feel, not up to what he's racing on Saturday?
No, I think he's a hell of a good horse. But
so where does,
he does need to find a level because he's graduating from 3 to 4 and he's only getting a half a kilo from weight for age horses.
Okay.
So he does need to find that level. I think he can find the level, but I think he does need to find it. All reports from John O'Benner is that he's trained brilliantly. The last 10 days has been very, very good. He said he won't be losing any sleep tonight. He'll have a very good night's sleep, which means that everything's going well for Scott Bass. And he's not a horse that everything has gone well for him.
I think he can win, absolutely no doubts, but I do think we're underselling Ocean Emperor. I know it's only trials and people look at them and go, well, you know, these things are different, but both his trials have been outstanding. He looks a very fit, very hard horse. I think he'll jump close to the speed. I wouldn't be stunned to see him lead the race.
What about a horse like Savvy Coat, Jason? Obviously, it's just come out as the three-year-old of the year. Is she up to this, or is there a few things that are against her in your mind?
She's drawn to probably settle in the back half of the field, and again, she's going to have some high-quality horses that she's going to have to run past. I'd be wanting to back her over more ground, and I just really want to see her.
I don't have her
priced as a bet.
She appeals more at the 16 and the 2,000, doesn't she? And if she could win either of the other two legs and not surprise, I think for most people, punters included, she would surprise by winning tomorrow because she's had no trials. I know they're not big trials people, the Pitmans, but you know, it's an awfully long run to come off to beat star trialists and race-winning performers like Melody Bell.
What do you think of Start Wondering?
I'm willing to forgive Tarapa because Tarapa is a track at the moment that races where any horse fails there, I'm willing to forgive it. Mm. I know that sounds harsh on Tarapa, and I know he won the BDC Sprint there the last 2 years under similar circumstances. He can win, but the fact that Jonathan has chosen to stick with High Flyer and puts Leith on Start Wondering suggests to me, maybe potentially meanly, that the best of Start Wondering may be in the past. I'm not saying that's true, but
I have a feeling it might have been an earlier commitment to one race and then this race for each of those horses, but I think I think he's happy to be on High Flyer. That's the bottom line, isn't it, Jonathan Parks? And when you look at what he can do, and when you look at what he did in Australia, conceding weight to horses that have Quinella at a Group 3 mile race, you know, it's very good form for this. I think he races well in a fresh state. I really don't see an issue with the 1400, even though a lot of chat is about 1600 or more being his goer. I really like him over 1400. He maps brilliantly.
Start One Ring for you?
High Flyer I was talking about.
Start One Ring for you, though.
Look, you're getting 21s. Look, if you like the horse, then you can have a spec, because at his best, he's in the fight.
He's won very similar races.
That's right. He's got the blinkers on. If you can forgive him, Tadapa, and by all accounts, the reports from that is that Jonathan Parks felt that he was actually feeling okay. He wanted to let down, but just didn't cop the track at all.
What about Close Up? We're talking about the inside being on. Close Up's got barrier one. We know how good the horse is. If we're willing to forgive anything that comes out of Tarapa and doesn't perform, isn't Close Up a willing to forgive?
He looks like he maps to get nearly identical runners last year. So if he presents in that sort of form, then he'll have to go close, you'd have to say. You got flushed out wide at Tadapa, and that was that.
Jake Bayliss back in New Zealand. It's also good this week when you look at this field, all the good riders are back, and I think it undermines punter confidence so much over the winter when we have so many of our good riders not riding, Opie not riding, Jason Waddell not riding for a long period of time. You don't see Michael McNabb, over that winter period. I know he's gone offshore. Jake Bayliss left and come back. That's one of the key things about tomorrow, is so many good jockeys are back. I'm not looking at races and going, I don't want to back a horse with that person riding it. Predominantly, the horses I want to back tomorrow have good or outstanding riders on them.
What about Son of Mahir? I know he's at long odds. Stablemate a savvy cope, Jason, but he's got a very good record at 1400. His fresh up record says that he's here to run a cheeky race. Is the draw against him somewhat, though?
I think absolutely. I think if he was to draw sort of inside six and could sit midfield without having to do any work, then you'd say he's an outside chance of running it, being a genuine top three contender. I'd be shocked if he won his level. I haven't seen anything in what he's before. The level that he's performed to say that he could win this race. He's six now, and that's also the problem for a horse like Ocean Emperor, who's seven. They're very exposed at what they can do. And so whilst we see and look at a horse like Ocean Emperor and say, he looks brilliant at the trials, are we saying that he's improved? Because to what I've seen, he does need to be at least a length and a half better than what he's shown. But maybe that's the case.
What about Windspell quickly? Fresh up, obviously it's been in Australia. How do you line him up with his Australian
form? Best 1400 metre, his best form in Australia was early on in his prep over 1400, and he ran third in the Kennedy Mile. But he just looks in the reports out of the camper that he's going to need the run, and it'll be better throughout the prep.
That's what Jono was saying, and they weren't stunned by the trial last week where they were thrilled with the Scott Bates trial. So I think they would be very surprised if he beat home Scott Bates.
Okay, what do we do? I know it's a long way out from the race, but with what we know now, who would you back?
I like High Flyer each way. In fact, I can't see him missing each way. If I'm going to bet in the race and I'm spending 5 units, which could be $10, $1 or $100 for you, I'm going to have 3 or 4 units High Flyer, and I'm going to have 1 or 2 units Ocean Emperor. I just can't get out of my head the fact he could be on the speed, get an easy time between the 1,000 and the 600 and be very hard to catch.
I really like High Flyer as well. I think he maps beautifully. I like what he's done in Australia. I assume that he's come back well. All the reports are that he's come back well. It's a task. He's been over to Sydney. He's come back. Sensible Princess is a bit of a speck on the basis that I loved what I saw from her against her own sex last season. I thought she was brilliant up against some really highly touted fillies and mares. She's drawn to make it really hard for Lisa Rawpress, but I think if they're positive, they might find a slot. She can keep her momentum going. It wouldn't surprise me if she won. I can't believe I'm not having a bet on Scott Bass, because I think if there's any horse in this race I want for the spring, it's him.
I can't believe neither of us took Melody Bell. She was so good, and she'll get the 1400, but she's getting to the point in the market, I think, Matt, where she's close enough to her mark.
And that's
$3.5, $4, so much can go wrong for every horse in this race, and that includes her, that one spot too far back may be too much for her. And she's too short for me for what she is, even though I think she's a very, very good
That's exactly the point. I've got her and Scott Bass both marked at $7.50. They're very good chances. They're leading chances. But I can't quite back either.
I'm going to ask you something which I very rarely ask people, because I don't think people care if you're excited. But are you excited about this tomorrow?
I am, yeah.
So am I.
Because there are some horses that it signals the start of their spring and where they could go. I would love to see Scott Bass perform in Australia. You think that if High Flyer runs well, he'll be back over there.
Ocean Emperor is being set for the Cox Plate, of all things. So it just...
And on the undercard, we've got Melbourne Cup aspirants.
It feels like it starts tomorrow, Matt. It feels like we've been going through this thing and we've got through winter together as a group in the jumps. People
holding
have
hands,
us.
Some of us.
I think, exactly. I feel like we've done
we've umbrellas. And it just feels like, thank God this is here. And if Bevan's right and the sun is shining tomorrow, it's going to feel like New Year's Day. So...
Can cause a solar eclipse, Bevan Sweeney. And mean, hopefully it's not clouds and
you
rain
mean
as well.
Physically?
No, you? Not physically.
Who would you back in this race? Or maybe who more than one?
Look, I think John Snow is the best horse in the race, where the 1400 fresh up is up his alley. But look, I'd be willing to back Scott Bass, I think, based on his three-year-old form and the discussion that Jason and I had before, being hopeful that he can take his three-year-old form and lift, as you say, into that open level. I think he's certainly good enough.
Everything signals that he can, you know.
Have either of you ever thought about being a race caller, like budding young race caller?
I called to trials once.
OK, was it good?
No, it was terrible.
OK. No. Do you want to hear a really good call? Take a listen to this.
As they go for home, Shinzig and Miss Potential, they race to the 300 metres together. Here's the jewel after them. Then we've got on the outside Irish Rover, Bellmuse coming across heels as well. Miss Potential, Shinzig over on the outside, the jewel wide of Bellmuse, and look at Excellence! Look at Excellence flying right down the outside! Amazing! He is a megastar!
Hello and welcome into your very first edition of The First Call Moneymakers, where each and every week I'll be getting you the inside information straight from the track, and hopefully we can make a little bit of cash over the coming months. Let's get straight into it. Week one, horse one, goes by the name of Ripper Eagle. It comes from the Tony Pike stable. Check out the trial at Tateco in early August. Hampered on the turn and ended up finishing up over the top of them for an easy victory. I spoke to Tony Pike afterwards and he was very positive about this horse. He said we haven't seen the best of it yet and he thinks it's in for an exciting spring. Takes its place Ruakaka Saturday, Ripper Eagle.
Ripper Eagle and right down the outside is What a Cracker. Ripper Eagle strikes the front. Ripper Eagle, the Rip Van Winkle gelding in over the Burgundy filly.
The second horse I wanted to talk about takes its place in the Group 1 Tarzino Trophy on Saturday. Risky, I know, but the male is so strong that I just couldn't leave it out. It's Melody Bell. If you had any doubts about her backing up after that tough run at Tarapa, they've been put to bed because her work this week has been sensational. Melody Bell, Tarzino Trophy.
Melody Bell's going to get the last run from Frankolita. Julius Melody Bell. Julius Melody Bell lunged and made it very, very close. I'm not sure.
I hope you've enjoyed your first week's edition of The First Call Moneymakers. I'll be back same time, same place next week.
What a fantastic way to start Emily Boston there with her money makers. I feel like we should get our own cartoons, but I don't think ours would look that flash, to be fair.
I don't think it'd be very fun drawing up cartoons of us.
Good three-year-old racing on Saturday, the first of the three-year-old races where we start to piece the spring three-year-old puzzle together with the El Rocco Sir Colin Meads Trophy. Sir Nate returns to the races as a $3.30 favourite. $4.24 Chugy Express and then $3.80 for Stella Noir. Plenty of word around about the pie crust.
Three horses short in the market, all of them with very strong claims. As you mentioned, Tony Pike really likes his filly Stella Noir. Sir Nate has trialled outstandingly and by all accounts has progressed positively out of his two-year-old year. And Chigi Express has run some super races, with most of them being unlucky, but was quite dominant on the Hastings track as a two-year-old.
What have you got in terms of a speed, Matt? With Aidan being away, we've entrusted you with the job.
Cyber Attack, I thought, with Tiny Terror, horses that could compete for the lead. Chigi Express should get one of the better runs in the race. How Sir Nate jumps is the question. Could position one spot closer west, I have Segunto, or, depending on how it jumps, might drift a bit further back. Not quite sure what is going to be the tactics for Stella Noir, given the draw. Could be positive, Or they could try and take a set and have her unleashed down the outside.
Let's take a look at Stella Noir. And, Michael, I'll get you to talk to us about this run of Stella Noir. Is this a horse that we could confidently back first up based on this trial?
Had a good talk to Tony Pike this week about how good she is. He said she's the best of his three-year-olds, and she just canters up to them here. This is the horse who created the huge impression at Ellerslie last year, winning Fresh Up, and people were like, wow, but wasn't eligible for Karaka, for the Karaka Million, so therefore couldn't go to that, so they played the patient game. Went to Cambridge to a jump out back about May and won by 10 lengths. So she's obviously very talented. A better barrier draw would make me and everybody else a bit more confident. Tony said, look, we'll leave that up to Leith. We'll see what happens at the start and could potentially go forward. If she's as good as he thinks she is, then she might be early second favourite for the 1,000 guineas behind a horse like Avantage. I'm still reluctant to back her now at 3.8, Jason. It's getting very tight in the market for a horse who's going to need to be coming around some very good horses. Soon 8's interesting because in that trial, his most recent trial, he came out of the gates like he had been stung by a bee. He just went boom and landed 2 lengths in front of them. If he does that, I think the way they balanced him up on the trial and let him go in the straight, he is clearly a better chaser. But if he does that, they might be keen, if the track's playing that way, to stay in front. And all of a sudden, you're talking about Kiji Phoenix and horses like Stella Noir running past him. So I think he's a better chaser, but if he lands in front, he might be the horse to beat the way the track plays. I think how the track plays for the day is going to be hugely important to this race, because if they're coming down the outside, Stella Noir, I love. If they're leading from the inside, Surnate would appear to hold all the aces.
Yeah, it's one of those interesting ones, Surnate, isn't it? Because at times during his two-year-old career, he jumped well and was put right there. Opie Bosson rode him one time at Trentham and was able to hold the trail from an inside draw. I'd be surprised if they ended up leading with him. I think there's enough pressure outside him that even if he jumped in, they'd probably concede the trial, but that's not going to necessarily be a bad place anyway.
No, the trial at Hastings, often they come around the bend, they drift out a little bit. The gap usually comes. Kiji Phoenix, I thought, was not only good over the winter, but his trial at Tarapa was excellent because in this trial, well, this is the race, but in the trial he had subsequent to this, he found the line really well, probably better than a lot of horses have in wet tracks. This is him at Hastings back in the autumn. The horse who runs second here, Harbourside, goes to an easier and earlier race here, but he absolutely distanced them, and I'm absolutely sure he's rock hard fit for this. That could be crucial because he's going to be fitter than Surnate and Stella Noir. Just where he posses up in comparison with those horses is important.
I really like him as a horse. I think he might land upside Surnate in the run, and there's a good chance that with a proactive ride could get first run if Surnate is stuck on the inside. Quite how good Stella Noir is the uncertain thing. It's hard to define that at this stage. Obviously, you've got to highly respect the reputation that she holds within the Pike stable, but Chi-Gi Expresses really look good at times, was dead stiff at Tarapa, was excellent breaking maidens at Hastings, and then in the Castletown looked all over a winner before getting bombed. I can't believe what happened there, but I looked at the race 1,000 times. He just changed legs the last 50 metres as, you know, Cameron tried to balance him up, lost all momentum in the ground and got slingshotted by a horse that's actually trialled up in its own right well, London Express. So I want to be with Chi-Gi Express at the price.
It feels like every multi that I take.
I know.
Changed legs the last 50. What's your bet in the race, Michael?
I'm going to wait till the track plays out early early doors and make a decision. But I'll probably back both Kiji Express and Stella Noir, thinking I've got one on the speed and one off the speed, and they might both get beaten by Surnate.
Jason, your bet?
Yeah, at this stage, it's Kiji Express.
Okay.
I really like him as a horse.
Would you wait, though, to see how the track's playing? Or does it not matter for him?
I think for him at the moment, he's priced up that I'm happy. I've actually priced him up favourite. So 420 to me is a backable price. So. Okay. Yeah, maybe it's just a case of half-staking and waiting, but I'm happy with the 420 now.
You thought that was a tricky race. What about this one? We turn over to the Reliable Man Trophy with plenty of very good stayers lining up in a fresh or second-up state here. One of those, the reigning Auckland Cup winner, ladies first, $8.50, Charles Road, the stayer of the year from Sunday night, $6. Cicada, sevens, down to $8.50. Nymph Monte and Big Mike. Well, he's the newcomer to the ranks. He's got no weight on his back, $6.50 and $2.35. He's the first question I want to ask you, Jason. How does Big Mike come into the big boys?
Well, I think in the map, superbly. And Ashvin Gundasamy claims four. He can claim to the full extent. 49 kilo is what he's listed as being able to ride down to. So that's significant. He's getting 11.5 kilo from Charles Road and Zicada. So in the old, that's what, a stone, one stone, 11 pound, or something like that.
It's a lot.
That seems like a lot.
I can't remember the last time I saw a horse go around with 49 kilos on its back in a big race.
So I just assume it's going to be handlebars down by Gundasamy, and he'll get there pretty easily anyway. There just seems like very little pressure.
He's still going to have to rate it, though, isn't he?
Sure. Not an easy thing to do.
You go through the first five or six runners here, and they're class, and two of them are aiming at a Melbourne Cup. But they are stayers coming back to 1600. He raced a little bit through the winter. He's going to jump on the speed. It's going to be awfully hard for those horses to get over top of him. I wouldn't be surprised if one of them did. But the question is, which one of these stayers produces that occasional slashing stayers run? Zicada's trial was very, very good.
Yeah.
I spoke to Andrew Forsman about that, and he said, look, High Lad tends to go better fresh of the two of them. Ladies first five to, but not, we know how good they are, but this isn't their target.
Yes.
This isn't the race they're being aimed for. Whereas for Big Mike, this might be close enough to about where he's going to get to in the next couple of months.
Is he like a token bet in the race? I feel as though you don't want to spend big.
No, look, I don't want to spend big because I think one of the stayers might swoop and I'll go, well, how did I not back that?
Yep.
And it could be Zicada on his trial. But I do think, like you, weight and map suggest Big Mike is the bet.
Yeah, that trial of Zicada was superb, beating Big Mike. But 11.5 kilo, and I would guess at the 600, six lengths maybe or more. Not easy, even though in the trial he was very powerful.
If it gets to dead, they're going to come home in 35s and change, or 36s. And then you're coming home in 34 to beat them on dead coming wide. Well, that's not going to happen very often.
High Lad, I think if they're positive with him, he could maybe roll forward throughout the sort of the first half of the race. Five to Midnight, out of those four, he trialled up really nicely. He, to me, looks like a horse that'll get a nice soft run, and he could lob into a place at pretty good odds at $3.90 to me. He's probably going to be a bit more settled, a bit more in front of the three above him in the market and in the race. So he looks like an attractive place price.
We've got to turn the page to race number two on the card out of Hastings on Saturday. He sees the return of Tiakau Shark. He hasn't raced since his fourth in the 2,000 guineas behind Embellish, and that form's well and truly stacked up. He's 450 v 360 for Mee Hall. He's a year older. He's won five from five, $4.
That's drift. That's a drift, isn't it, for Tiakau Shark?
Yeah, surprising price, and living on a prayer, $6. With the market, is the price a reflection of the fact that Gift of Power may punch forward, find itself on the speed?
Okay, my apologies. Actually, it was 450. I thought it opened at 420, Tiakau Shark. But yes, Gift of Power and Decision Stradivarius will compete. I wouldn't be surprised to see Gift of Power be aggressively ridden and sit alongside the Decision and not be caught three wide, but it just depends on the intent of Jason Waddell on Stradivarius. Mee Hall settles midfield and probably, well, I think in front of Tiakau Shark, but I think they might again sit up in the mid stages of this race.
Okay, we'll take a look at Mee Hall and see what it did last time to the races. Here it is, Justin behind the pace. He is a son of Ifraj. Michael, do you have concerns about him in a fresh state taking on what could be a very nippy field of smart horses?
Every time he goes to the races, he impresses me, but I wasn't blown away by the trial at Taraba. And I think a lot of riders have been holding on to these horses during these trials because they don't want to let their heads go on the wet tracks. Sure, he can win, but I think the best horse in this race might be Tiakau Shark. I think he's a very good horse, and his trial at Tateko, I just loved it. I'm not sure he's a natural 1,200 metre horse. I think he'll be better over distance, up to 1,600. But I do think he might just be a horse who can come out and go bang. And I think 450 after the race might sound awesome for him. So Gift of Power, I think, has been beautifully placed, and I really liked her trial at Taupo. But I do think that if she can't lead here, it's going to be hard for her to win. I love Tiakau Shark as a bet in this race.
Okay, but interestingly, between Gift of Power and Indecision, like Indecision, there's no inferior form-wise at her best, and I think she'll really like the slow track. So I don't think Bayliss, if he can get her away, and sometimes she's not sort of the cleanest to get away in decision, but when she gets her own way in front, her level is no different to Gift of Power to me.
I think the one thing with Tiako Shark, and let's remember this, Tiako have a lot of horses at a very high level. They can trial and work against each other, and we saw Melody Bell benefit from that when it came out, and we've seen a couple of their horses come out fresh and run very well. Just remember that when you're looking at Tiako Shark tomorrow, because they have an enormous army of horses to get each other fit with, and he might be fitter than a lot of people think after this longer break.
It's incredible, isn't it? 5 from 5, Mihal, but that trial where Leithinus basically dropped his hands at the top of the straight, didn't ask for much at all from Mihal, but that run of Tiako Shark at Mata Mata that day, when he was back and wide and still came into it and won going away by something like 3 lengths, like that was a serious, serious performance. The run home was very good, matched up well with Cote d'Or on the day, who performed in the Mata Mata Cup. I agree with you when you say that this looks like he could be the most progressive.
He's been one of the best trialists of the spring, no doubt.
How much weight would he have carried when Opie was on him last time at the Te Tiko?
More. but isn't it good to see Opie back now riding at a decent weight, because, as I said, punter confidence is so jockey-based.
What's your bet in the race?
Well, the Shark, for sure.
The Shark? You?
The Shark.
OK, stay with us here on The First Call. We go to Australia and we talk money next. Stay tuned.
Fiscolo, though, 100 metres out, 2 on Savile Row. Hugo Fiscolo kicking, and then the shades of Atlante. Hugo Fiscolo won the guineas.
Melt oozed up on the outside, took the lead, and goes away for the win. It's Dan's Dance in front here with 100 metres to go. That's 5 for the day for the team. And Dan's Dance bolted in.
Geez, an exciting time of the year when you open both race books and you see some of last season's better three-year-olds resuming. Well, that is the case at Ruakaka on Saturday. We look to see Dan's Dance return to the races alongside a host of other very smart horses, Jason. Spring's well and truly in the air.
Yeah, lines up in race number 6, a rating 82, 1400, and there are horses that I would be expecting to see in group races and group one races potentially. Dan's Dance is aimed up for the Livermore, so this is her first step towards that. In that race, look, you've got Excalibur, who's looking for a cups path. You've got Hello It's Me, who's potentially going to the Livermore as well, coming through New Zealand Cup aspirant, and a horse called Andoya, so we're not sure where he's going to go, but he'll run well probably into fourth or fifth.
It's a great race, and there's the first race on the card, the Maiden's a great race, but the horse I'm looking forward to seeing the most is Melt. Melt could end up potentially in a 2,000 guineas over in Aussie, or at least could be one of the favourites behind Avantage for the 1,000 guineas here, and that might depend on what Stella Noir does tomorrow. But Melt's a really good horse. I saw it at the Avondale Trials recently, and again, the head wasn't let go. So many horses, it's hard to judge, because, Matt, they're not letting their heads go because it's been so heavy in the north. She'll appreciate going back to Ruakaka. Excellent barrier draw. I'm not sure she's a win bet because she'll be short and it's 1,000 metres, but, gee, I'm looking forward to seeing her back.
Your star performance in that race is going to be force to be reckoned with as well.
Is it the fixed odds?
It's a tote market.
That's a tote, that's what I thought. That 2.9 would have got me, I would have run out the door. But, yeah, that's the tote market, so.
But we'll be previewing all those races, skipping through them for the Punters Lounge website.
So. It'd actually be nice if that meeting was on Sunday, so we could fully concentrate on that as well as concentrating on Hastings, because, man, it's going to be a fun day tomorrow.
Certainly is. Best bets from last week. I think it's time we refresh this and get going. Let's take a look at the camp total, the comp totals for our best bets from last week. I'm still 9:30 down.
That was relatively consistent. Everybody got zero.
Yeah, cop that.
It wasn't a great week, to be fair, but it sort of shaped as a tricky one given some of the track conditions.
We're only $50 down overall, though, so we just need to lift. What's your best bet this week?
I'm going to the first race at Hastings. I think a horse. Look, it's some people are going to look at Gorbachev and say, why is he tipping out Gorbachev? But I think he comes into the first race so well, particularly with the apprentice claim. I think he's thrown, and if he's better than $3, he'd be climbing aboard in a big way.
I like race three at Hastings. I think it's either Lankawi or Lankawi, one or the other. I'm not sure, because if Coey's Coey, this might be Lankawi. I think it'll jump on the speed. I love Peter Mackay's horses around those type of tracks where they can jump and run, and I think the three-year-olds get into this special conditions race very, very nicely at 54.5. Hasn't trialled, which is one little concern for me, but gee, he's going to be hard to beat. And you're going for the grey girl, Dance, Dance, Dance.
Love her, Dance, Dance, Dance. Another case of one of the better three-year-olds resuming. Maybe over shorter than what it would like, but we've seen through the last couple of months, especially with our late summer, early spring three-year-olds, when they come back at this time of year, they're very hard to beat first up. And I'm looking to make some coin with Dan's Dan's Dance at Ruakaka. Stay with us here on The First Call. We're going to chat to Dan O'Sullivan, our Australian expert, next. And he's found a couple that I think you'll like. Stay tuned.
But Sunline holds her at bay, and Sunline, the first lady of the turf, wins it by a length. Sunline is clear, though, near the line, and the champion mare, the queen of the turf, is back on her throne tonight. Sunline's won it a length and a half.
Well, we've just been talking about Dan's Dan's Dance here in New Zealand. She's one horse who ran in behind Unforgotten at their last start. Of course, Unforgotten's had a run since then, and she lines up in the Chelmsford on Saturday. And Dan O'Sullivan from Australia joins us to chat Australian form. Dan, how are things over there?
Yeah, really good, thanks.
Let's talk about the Chelmsford. Obviously, you've got Unforgotten in here. Is this the sort of horse that we can base some bets around, or have you found something outside of her?
Look, I think it's a really open race, incredibly open, and I think personally it's really difficult to bet with confidence. So I think that $3.90 about Unforgotten is probably a little bit short. I'm around $4.40, and that's being as optimistic as I can about her rate of improvement. Look, there's no doubt that she can win the race. It was a good first up run behind Winks. She's got all the scope to improve. Look, on her rating, she's certainly not clear cut over these, and it's a large field. She tends to get back a little bit. She'll be reliant on a little bit of luck. And look, as I said, she can win, but it's, you know, I don't want to back her personally. And if she did win and I missed out, I certainly wouldn't think I've missed the best bet of the weekend. There are a stack of other chances in the race, I think. Horses like Single Gaze, if she's solid in the market, to suggest she's going to come back well first up, she can win. Prized Icon, Sedanza, Cabeza de Barca, who also ran well behind Winks, and Religify, they're all horses capable of winning here, and they're significantly better prices than Unforgotten. So, look, as I said, I think it's a really difficult race. If I was to have a bet, I'd be looking at a horse like Religify to run a place. He's really big odds. I think he's around a sort of $18, $19 mark. I think he was ridden quite conservative last start when he took a sit. I expect that up to a mile he may be ridden a bit more positively here. He's definitely going to be fitter. And look, he's got a string of ratings that can be very competitive in this race and certainly run a place or even sort of, you know, go close to winning. So I think, you know, at massive odds, just taking him to run a place is probably a decent bet if you had to have one.
New Zealand Bloodstock Memsey lines up on Saturday as well. Good field assembled. Great to see Vega Magic at the races. What do you make of this year's running of the Memsey, Dan?
Oh, look, I think it's a really good race. It's a pretty deep race, genuine Group 1. For me, it's impossible to go past Vega Magic here. I've priced him at $2.30. I know he's $2.80 with you guys. He was awesome first up. He ran a 108 rating, a really serious Group 1 performance. We've seen Voodoo Lad frank the form and the rating with his subsequent win. And that win of Vega Magic was similar to his first up win last prep, where he went 107 and then he went on to win this race easily. So even if I forecast him back a little bit off his first up run here, he's still a dominant top pick. He maps ideally in this race. He looks to just follow the leader, Jungle Edge across, and park probably a length off him. If Showtime on the inside wants to kick up and try and control the race, then that'll put a bit more speed, and Vega Magic will be able to slot in just behind them. So he's clearly the best horse in the race, and he's going to get the best run. So it's a really strong profile for a great betting prospect in my book. Kamentari is the main danger in the market, $4.40, but I must admit I don't like him at all here. I've got him around the $8 mark. He was good first up, but then he had opportunity to progress second up, and he was disappointing behind Winks. Now he turns up here at Caulfield. He's drawn very awkwardly. It's hard to imagine a scenario where he's going to easily get across and get a comfortable run. He's going to be relying on a lot of luck, or he may need to do a bit of work early. And look, even if he was to improve significantly to his absolute best ratings, it still may not be good enough to win. We've still got Vega Magic, who's clearly better, and even Happy Clapper holds some superior figures. So for me, $4.40 is well and truly under the odds. $6.50 Happy Clapper, which is similar to the market. Look, his ratings last prep can certainly challenge here. Just a little query whether he can produce that first up in Melbourne. But he's a very, very smart horse. And look, all of the others, there's a few there that can run well, but to be honest, unless one of them really jumps out of the ground, they're really going to be relying on Vega Magic and perhaps a horse like Happy Clapper to run well and truly below their best. So for me, Vega Magic.
Got Caulfield and Randwick on Saturday. Both of your best bets returned to collect for our viewers last week. What have you found this week?
I think Vega Magic's definitely the best at Caulfield. And at Randwick, I'm going to go to race six. I want to back La Romaine here. He's in the tramway. He's up against Pierrato, of course, beat Kamentari first up. The market has them 330, Pierrato, and La Romaine 370. I think that should be the other way around. He was brilliant first up, La Romaine. He returned with a new career pick, which is just consistent with what's happening with the Chris Lee stable at the moment. They're really, really flying. He's got a string of consistent ratings. He's best. He's better than Pierrata at this stage. And I think at the price difference in the market, he's a great bet on what is really a deep and difficult Randwick card.
All right, Dan, thanks so much for your time. I hope that you enjoy the coverage here from New Zealand Group 1 race day on Saturday to talk all things Tanzino. Let's head to Petone and Lincoln with Thad Taylor at the racing desk. Thad, good morning. It's that time of year. I can see your excitement.
Oh, Matthew, just going through those fields at Hastings. Absolutely, we're excited here. Had a little bit of rain overnight, I see. I think the track down somewhere around a slow 8, but no rain forecast for the next couple of days, I don't think so. I think everyone's going to get their chance, and if they do, it's going to be an absolutely fantastic race day.
Now, these markets, well, the market for the big Group 1 on Saturday has been out for some time, pre-barrier draws, riders and that sort of thing. What have you noticed with the money through the progression of this market?
Yeah, I guess the first point, and you would have touched on it, Frank Lettice gets into the field, which is it's a good thing for the race. I think around an $8.50 chance, Frank Lettice. But I guess most of the money has been around the two favourites, and I say two favourites, High Flyer and Melody Bell. Melody Bell, $4.80. High Flyer, $6 now. They've both been heavily backed, so they're expecting High Flyer to have come back from Australia particularly well. They're expecting a big run, clearly. The money's dried up for John Snow with that barrier draw, guys, the awkward barrier draw for him, just out there in around 11 or 12. He's going to obviously go forward, but yeah, he could have a toughish old run out there. Ocean Emperor, very solid, around $10. Good money for Scott Bass as well at $7.50. So what I'm basically saying is it's an excellent betting race, but at this stage, Melody Bell and High Flyer.
The Rocker Sir Colin Meads Trophy, you've got three runners well in the market. Can you give us a lead towards any one of those?
Oh, I can, Jay. I'm glad you went there, Jason. He's written down on my list. Stella Noir resumes. $4.20 to $3.80. I'm sure you saw the little move there that we've had to make since opening. The trials were very good. You were probably touched on those as well. And there's a big rap on this horse. So Stella Noir is the way they're going. Obviously up against Sir Nate, who brings good form into a race like this, but they really think that the Stella Noir is a real up-and-comer.
Thad, just quickly before we get into the special, Dan's Dance and Melt. They both line up at Ruakaka. What can you tell for those punters who might just be sitting at home, maybe wanting a wee lead from you into those two horses?
I can tell you there's a strong lead for Dance Dance Dance. Open second favourite behind the stablemate. Hello, it's me, Matthew. Yeah, we quickly got knocked into shape. Bad move, mistake. We were fairly quick to abort that mission. We're into $3.80 now. I think $3.60 now. We just had a little scratching out of the race around Dance Dance Dance, but no doubt it will start favouring that race. Milk steady as she goes. Probably didn't pay to watch that market as the day progresses. There hasn't been a flurry at this stage, but there has been a flurry around Dance Dance Dance.
What about tab.co.nz option one, selection one this week, Thad?
Going for the unbeaten galloper, guys. We love an unbeaten galloper. Customers certainly do. 5 from 5, Mehall, $3.60 in the final field market. It will be $2.80 in option one, selection one, and if it runs second or third, and the unlikely occurrence is a 5 from 5, we'll give you your money back. So $2.80, option one, selection one. If it does get knocked off by Gift of Power or Tiaki our Shark, we'll give you money back if it runs second or third.
Have a good weekend, Thad. Thanks for your time.
I definitely will. Cheers, boys.
$2.80, Jason, for the special. What are your thoughts on that? Is it something that you'd be willing to be a part of?
Yeah, that's a fair price. Just spoke with Kieran Murdoch in the last commercial break. He is on his way down to Hastings as we speak. Asked her about the trial at Tarapa and whether she was concerned. And she said, look, we didn't want to knock him around. We didn't want to put too much pressure on him, given the track conditions. And Leith Innes executed the will of the trainers perfectly. She's happy with how he will present tomorrow. And you'll get to see him parade as well. But no knock on Mehall for tomorrow.
I think it'll be $4 on the totes of the 280s unders for what you're getting back, to be honest. I'll stay out of that one.
I see Patrick Heron lining up there too in the Chelmsford at Randwick. So keep an eye on Patrick Heron, of course, the White Robe Lodge Galloper. Let's talk about our bets for the weekend. And Jason Tarn, it's your turn to start this week.
Where are we starting? We're starting from Ruakaka. We're starting from Hastings. Ruakaka. In the first race, I thought Pacific Presents is a good each-way bet. Spoke with Michelle Bradley and said that she has been working very well Pacific. Amazing As looks very well placed, an excellent run on the clock in comparison to a couple of others last start. I thought Little Specs on Creative Genius and Karchi in race four, they look overs even though there is going to be a scratching in race number four with, I anticipate, Aim Smart starting at Hastings. Gorbachev, the best of the weekend. Chiji Express, look, I'm playing against the market here with Stella Noir, the reputation in the money trail. High Flyer and Sensible Princess in race number 7, and I've left out Scott Bass and Melody Bell. Ruakaka, Multi, Amazing As, and Divine Veil, the place. He drops back from a really... She drops back from a really good race, Vine Veil.
Just call it It.
She.
That's easier.
She.
Horse.
Yeah.
I'm going to just go to Hastings because I can't wait for it. Look, I'll go High Flyer each way, and I'm wanting to go heavy enough, but I am going to cover on Ocean Emperor. And I really like Lankawi in race 3. I just think it maps to be in the right place. I love their horses around that track, and it comes in beautifully at the 54.5. A lot of positives there. It's a good way to build a bank early doors.
I'm going to take a $1,000 multi, Tiakau Shark into Melt. No, I'm not.
Well, you've got a bit to play with.
$20 Quinella Major, Tom and Jake the Must. Surely they run 1-2. Race number 2 at Ruakaka. Kiri Eliason, I like it. Back 2 grades and it's only up 0.5 kilo. Jasmine Fawcett with a really good book of rides on Saturday. Dance Dance Dance, Melt and Inanna. Inanna, I don't think it's raced since maybe a week after it's run in the 2000 guineas. Tiakau Shark, race number 2 there at Hastings. But I do like the $2.80 money back if Mehall runs second or third. Lankawi with you, Michael, there in race number 3. Aim Smart, race 4, Sir Nate. Just a $30 win bet on him. I just thought of the price from the barrier draw. Just interested to see how he comes back in Scott Bass. If he brings his 3-year-old form and lifts, as Jason said, he could be winning. Tiakau Shark, Lankawi, Aim Smart, Sir Nate. Just to, you know, I'm trying to get to that $10,000 mark. And then Amazing As in race 3 at Ruakaka and Kiri Eliason race number 4, $400 spend there.
Crossing the boss with moneymakers.
Yeah,
Emily
Cross
and Matthew Cross.
Hot cross bun.
Make some money.
Do you ever put those on?
Rail crossing.
Do you ever go to the tab and put that multi bet on yourself just in case it wins and you
sometimes
make some money? You do?
Yeah, I do. I do sometimes.
Everything that I put on there, I bet.
Yep. Not at the same amount.
No, but I do.
He doubles
what,
it.
What are you looking forward
to seeing most? What horse around the country are you looking forward to seeing most tomorrow?
Gee, I tell you what, this Stella Noir sounds like it'll be pretty special, so I'm interested to see if the word's right. What about you?
Maybe Tiakau Shark, because I know what to expect from the horses I've seen in the Tarzino. I know how good they are. Tiakau Shark might be a Group 1 horse. I do not know the answer to that. I might know a bit more tomorrow.
I know what Brendan Popwell will be thinking tomorrow. Smedley is back in rating 65s at Ruakaka.
Just on that, not it's going to be too good a track for Smedley.
Well,
sure.
I know. But
just on that, we're still open for the head shave thing. Yeah?
Yeah, I think so.
So we're still going to hit 6,000?
TRB.co.nz/shave.
I'm chucking 100 and so is Greg O'Connor.
OK, I think I've put something in there already, and if you haven't, then I think you need to if you support the cause.
If you're back at winning, yes, you should do this at tomorrow.
Even a gold coin's enough, isn't it?
And obviously these saddle cloths are going to be signed by Connections of Each and auctioned on Gavel House to make more money for the Cancer Society.
OK, that's going to be good. TRB.co.nz/shave, isn't it? I'm looking forward to this. Bevan Sweeney, Aidan Rodley.
Bit of momentum there. Auckland Racing Club has got behind it. Tiako Racing has got behind it. There were a group of trainers on track at Matamata during the week that pulled some money together that have contributed to it. So, yeah, big thanks to all those in the industry that are supporting.
And if Stewie Lang tips a winner, he should also chuck in a hundy.
And shave his head.
And shave his head. What's he tipping, by the way, Stu?
Stu's tips, let's have a look at them before we
did
go.
Did we overlook
We're
that?
Running out of time.
He gets paid good money for these, so he does. Really need to be putting these
let's
up
stock him to pay.
There we go, there's Stu's bets. Mason Roxanne, now that's the Valor Horse lining up on debut, and Danielle Johnson riding it in race one at Ruakaka. And just simply optimistic, he likes race six at Hastings, taking a Quinella there. TAB.co.nz/thepunters now, and you can find this. He likes Nymph Monty to run a place. There we go. You've put one out there, Parvina, and a $20 top three all up for a total spend of $160. Stu Lang, thank you, Stu, for being a part of the show, as per the norm. On behalf of Michael Guerin, Jason Tarn, and myself, happy Group 1 Eve to you. I hope you enjoyed the racing from Ruakaka and Hastings. Until next week, goodbye.